Today we're talking about Ohio. Said nobody ever. But yes, today we really are talking about Ohio and the Supreme Court. Because Ohio just purged their voter rolls in a way that made liberals very angry. Ohio's pretty much the definition of a purple state, having voted for the winning candidate every year since they picked Richard Nixon over JFK in 1960. Which, man, what a terrible candidate to break your near-perfect trend for. You guys are operating on a level above even the groundhog who predicts our weather and the octopus who predicts our World Cup games. Well, neither that, or you guys really like to go with whatever's trending. Now, whether this is a complete coincidence or not, candidates really want to win in Ohio. Which is what made some people alarmed when it was reported that
the Supreme Court heard arguments today in a case challenging the removal of hundreds of thousands of people from voter rolls in Ohio.
Whoa, hundreds of thousands of voters are all of a sudden being purged? In a system that was set up and has been in effect since 1994. Okay, still bad, but by this point the voting system is old enough to vote itself, and even old enough to become disenfranchised and forget about voting. Because the system's rigged, man! So yes, when you hear about hundreds of thousands of people being purged, it's not as though some guy just ran a search result for the last name Gonzalez and then hit delete all. This is a system that's been in place for essentially my life. So before we get into the constitutionality of this system, what is it?
If a voter doesn't cast a ballot for 2 years, a postcard or mailer is sent to the address listed on the voter's registration. If the voter doesn't respond and then doesn't vote for another 4 years, the voter is removed from the voting rolls without further notice.
Now this annoys liberals because they're about as likely to show up to the polls as a guy who clicks maybe on a Facebook RSVP. So instead of me telling you what people think, let's get into the source itself. And see what the justices had to say, because
the Supreme Court has ruled in favor of an Ohio policy to remove thousands of registered voters from its rolls.
In this case, Justice Alito delivered the opinion of the court. Now, Justice Alito really came out swinging, citing a Pew Center study on the study of states' election initiatives briefs from 2012, saying, "It has been estimated that 24 million voter registrations in the United States, about 1 in 8, are either invalid or significantly inaccurate. About 2.75 million people are said to be registered to vote in more than one state." Now, that's coming from the Pew Research Center, not a tweet from Red Pill Fake News Locker Up 85, because you bet there are 84 other people with that name. So I went to that document to make sure that everything was as it seems. And it turns out, surprise of the year, Supreme Court justices look for the truth rather than spew crap to serve their ideology. Very clearly it says, there were 24 million, or 1 in 8, voter rolls that were incorrect, with 1.8 million coming from deceased individuals, 12 million coming from incorrect addresses, and another 12 million duplicates. My god, I could do an entire episode about this alone. But furthermore, it specifically states that we had over 2.5 million people registered to vote in multiple states. Which, alright, maybe I'll give people registered in 2 states a pass. But come on, you don't Forrest Gump your way into getting registered to vote in more than 3 states. Alright, so quick sidetrack. Pew Research, how did you get such precise numbers? Because I'm assuming you did more than generalize everyone who didn't vote for 6 years as fraudulent. Oh, no, you didn't? Instead you buy voter lists and combine that information with data from the National Change of Address Database run by the US Postal Service, death records from the Social Security Administration, and lists from marketing firms and retailers used by commercial data aggregators. Seriously. I know we're talking about the constitutionality of Ohio's voter purging method, but before we continue, can we all just agree that that is, on every level, so much smarter of a method of finding these fraudulent voters than kicking people off the rolls if they don't vote in 6 years and return their mail? I feel like our government is the Bond villain who decides to strap him to a nuclear bomb in Fort Knox instead of shooting him with the perfectly good gun that's right there. So. Alright, back to the argument of constitutionality. Now, in 1993, the National Voter Registration Act passed. And, as you can imagine, this definitely was a thorn in the side of anyone who wanted to throw people off the voter rolls. Although, Justice Alito correctly pointed out that the National Voter Registration Act provided in that section that a state may not remove a registrant's name on change of residence grounds unless either the registrant confirms in writing that he or she has moved or the registrant fails to return a pre-addressed postage-prepared return card containing statutorily prescribed content. Yeah, they're sending you the card in the mail, and if you leave that thing out on the counter for years, just putting it off season after season right next to the unfinished Christmas and thank you cards, then who knows? To briefly point out the tragedy of this case, it was filed not by a hippie whose listed address was right here, man, but by an army soldier who had in his address temporarily relocated to Afghanistan and Iraq. As he put it, I started crying to come home after defending that fundamental right and to be told that I couldn't exercise it. That was heartbreaking. Don't worry, happy ending to that story though, because despite the fact that veterans might have been purged from the rolls, he still got enough votes to become mayor of his hometown. So good on ya, and thank you for your service. Alright, despite that potential glitch, because they include a prepaid return card, this is covered by the Constitution. Furthermore, subsection D treats the failure to return a card as some evidence, but by no means conclusive proof that the voter has moved. Instead, the voter's name is kept on the list for 4 years. Only if the registrant fails to vote during that period and does not otherwise confirm that he or she still lives in that district may the registrant's name be removed. Alright, I'm just gonna say it. This seems like it's going to be really hard to argue against. I mean, given the rules as they currently stand, this law should be about as controversial as Barney's radical stance that sharing is caring. Now, remember, the fact that a card is involved is key, because Justice Stephen Breyer wrote in the dissenting opinion saying, "The question is whether the supplemental process violates the National Voter Registration Act Section 8, which prohibits a state from removing registrants from the federal voter roll by reason of the person's failure to vote." In my view, Ohio's program does just that. Alright, now we've got some conflict. I like it. So, is the government sending you a card once and waiting 4 years enough? I mean, I know every time I get a piece of mail from a vague government agency asking me to confirm my address, I make sure to respond right away. Huh. This US government registry agency is headquartered in Nigeria. Well, whatever. According to Bayer, the fact that the majority of this purge is based on a time scale is enough to call it unconstitutional. But he goes further, saying it violates a section that says a state must put in a reasonable effort to remove eligible voters from the rolls. He points to subsection C of the National Voter Registration Act, which lays out the voter removal programs. According to that, you can only remove people if two things are true. Change of address information supplied by the Postal Service through its licenses is used to identify registrants whose addresses may have changed. Or, if it appears that the registrant has moved to a different residence address not in the same registrar's jurisdiction, the registrar uses the notice procedure described in subsection D2 to confirm the change of address. Now, I wasn't being subtle about emphasizing the word confirm back there, because while Alito says that not getting a return letter is confirmation enough that the person has moved, Bayer would say that's like your mom assuming you're lying dead in a gutter somewhere because you forgot to return her text. You have to put a little more effort into confirming what is going on. He even went as far as to say that it's a feature of human nature of which the dissent has apparently taken judicial notice, i.e., the human tendency not to send back cards received in the mail. You see, Aunt Hilda, I'm sorry I never got around to writing you back, but just ask the Supreme Court. It's my human nature. Now, to all those accusations, Justice Alito had one heck of a clapback. The dissents have a policy disagreement. Not just with Ohio, but with Congress. We have no authority to second-guess Congress or to decide whether Ohio's supplemental process is the ideal method for keeping its voter rolls up to date. The only question before us is whether it violates federal law. It does not. Okay, that's pretty much just a mic drop moment right there. It's not a question of how effective or good the system is, it's a question of do they follow the law. And in this case, because they send you that note after 2 years of inactivity, which I guess means that you have to vote every 2 years, primaries and presidential elections, or else the government will assume you moved. And because of that, they're following the letter of the law. Just maybe not the spirit of it. So people of Ohio, your right to vote, use it or lose it. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly Supreme Court Saturday episodes. As always, leave me a comment if you have an important case you think I should research, and thank you for watching!